This is the official podcast of the Oakland Raiders. Here's your host, Eddie Paskal.
Bonus episode time. That's right. Another special edition of the official Raiders podcast. Eddie Paskal here. And I know we dropped our draft review podcast yesterday, our draft recap, but content never sleeps, baby. So we're back. And we have a very exciting bonus episode today. It revolves all around the Raiders' second round draft pick, PJ Hall. PJ, obviously an interesting prospect, a dude who put up stupid numbers in college at Sam Houston State. And if everything goes right and this dude can be where he needs to be, is going to be a very productive member of the interior line for the Silver and Black. So we thought, hey, who better to talk to about PJ? Who better to, you know, dive into his psyche and what makes him tick and what he does really well as a football player than talk to his old head coach? So we welcomed in head coach of the Sam Houston Bearcats, Casey Keeler, not Casey, KC. And he was a really interesting guy, really energetic. He caught up with us in between meetings. He was at a coaching conference down in Texas. And like I said, you know, he broke down PJ. He broke down what he's really good at, where he wants him to get better, you know. And that moment where he said, hey, this dude can play in the NFL. And so we started it off real quick and basic. I said, Coach, how does it feel to have PJ Hall, your former pupil, as a news member of the Silver and Black? So Coach Keeler, first of all, thank you so much for taking the time with us today. I know it's a busy time of the year, but we certainly appreciate your time.
Well, absolutely. Anything for PJ. We're just so excited that he gets a chance to play at the highest level. And big Raiders organization fan, Rich Gannon, is a very good friend of mine. And I actually visited the Raiders when Rich was playing quarterback there. So obviously know the organization very well. And we're excited that he's going to be a Raider.
Oh, very cool. How'd you and Gannon link up? Gannon's one of our favorites.
Well, yeah, actually, I hosted Rich's brother on his visit to the University of Delaware. And Johnny, Rich's brother, came to Delaware. And I always say that I got Rich because he followed Johnny. So, and then obviously being the head coach of Delaware for a period of time, had a lot of interactions with Rich, alumni events, golf tournaments. He and I, some of the tournaments would play a ball with the alums off the same tee, you know. So, yeah, I've spent some time with him, and he is as sharp a football mind as you ever want to be around, and we're very proud, you know, in terms of what he did with the Raiders.
Little silver and black floating in your blood there, huh, Coach?
Absolutely.
So I got to ask, obviously we take PJ in the second round, and the first thing, I'll just get out of the way, I was reading that PJ can squat 700 pounds. Is that true?
It's more like 750.
750?
I've seen him do it where it's almost like a pause. I mean, like, you know, you see guys who will go down and they'll pop right up or almost like they don't go down to it. You know, he goes down past parallel. And, you know, here's a guy who at 308 pounds vertical jumped 38 inches. So, yeah, he's freakishly strong. Last year we recruited a kid named Caleb Jolivet, who was the 60-meter champion nationally in high school. So basically we recruited the fastest player in the country. I don't know if I had a bet who would win a 10-yard dash, because that's how quick PJ is off the line. Especially if it's ball movement, I would pick PJ over Caleb, and Caleb won the national championship for high schoolers in the 60 meters. So you're talking about a guy who's 308 pounds, who benched 2.25 36 times, who vertical 38, and is as quick as anything I've ever seen come off the ball.
So let me ask you this, Coach. What were your kind of – we'll go back in the Wayback Machine for a sec. What was your first – when you saw PJ that first time, when you – I assume you were involved in his recruiting process. What really stood out to you from a young PJ Hall?
Well, no, actually, we weren't. We got here, and a very interesting story. They had a kid on the roster, Rogan Henderson, and they took PJ and Rogan and gave them both to the tight end coach and said, you keep one of them. Because they were going to play this kid as like an H-back kind of thing. And fortunately, the tight end coach kept Rogan, and they moved PJ over to defensive line. So when we get here, my defensive line coach, Phil Petit, who had been with me at Delaware, who had been with me as a Division III coach at Rowan, and then came with me to Sam Houston, I remember like after the first practice, he goes, I don't think anyone knows what we have here. He goes, this kid is like a freakish talent. His quickness, his strength, his explosion, his ability to use his hands. I mean, he goes, Casey, this kid's special. And this was after one practice. And so we got PJ at about 235 pounds. And slowly, during the course of his career, he moved up to like 275. And then last year, when the season was over, I said, listen, we have a need in the interior. And quite honestly, I think for your career, you know, this could be a good move for you also. And so we agreed that, you know, we were going to get him up to 300-plus and play inside. And, you know, it seemed to work out for everybody.
Was that something he was receptive to, kind of being moved inside?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, he's a big kid. I mean, so 275 was something he was working at, you know, to keep at 275. So I think the ability to eat a little bit more freer was exciting for him.
Absolutely.
And also, I thought, you know, his size would translate better inside. And the other thing is, we thought we could get him some one-on-one matchups. And, you know, inside, those guys, he's just so quick and so powerful. He could really take advantage of some one-on-one matchups inside. The same time I say that, we played him a ton at end this year also. So it depends on down, distance, personnel. We would try to get PJ matched up in some good one-on-one situations because, again, freakishly strong, freakishly quick, and has really a tremendous ability to use his hands.
Yeah, man, I think in talking with, you know, some of the people around here, and, you know, we've been doing this for a little while now, is they say when they look at guys, regardless of where they go to school, but specifically coming from the FCS level, they go, you know, it doesn't matter really for us where you came from. The question that they look at or the thing that they really want to see is, does this guy produce? And, I mean, you look at PJ's numbers, and, I mean, they almost look like NCAA video game numbers. I mean, with all the tackles for losses, with all the sacks, I mean, really, what kind of made him as productive as he was?
Well, and the thing that, you know, the one knock on PJ was, does he play 100% every snap? I'm like, listen, we've led the country like three of the last 4 years, you know? We'll get 100, we had 118 snaps against Texas Tech. Now, they had 108 against us. So our defensive guys play a lot of extra snaps because the up-tempo offense we play. I said, and here's a kid who's asking on special teams. I mean, he's the one who got himself on punt protection. He's the one who got himself on punt block and field goal block. He's the one saying, hey, I don't want to leave the field. So here's a guy who as a big man, played a lot of snaps. And like I said, it just tells you a little bit about his character when a lot of guys are taking that play off on a field goal block, and he's making those plays and blocking, you know, field goals and extra points and blocking punts and doing those kind of things.
You know, I'm glad you brought up the field goals and the punts blocking and all that stuff, because, you know, just looking at that aspect of his game, he reminds me a lot of a guy that we used to have here, Danico Autry, who just recently signed with the Indianapolis Colts. And Danico just had such a knack for getting one of those big paws up and batting down those kicks and those punts. And, I mean, obviously PJ did the same thing extremely well at the college level. Is there a secret for guys being able to have that kind of hidden, you know, hidden weapon in their arsenal? I mean, it's one of those things that, as I mean, I'm sure as you know, Coach, it can completely change the course of a game.
Oh, and it's changed many games for us. I mean, playoff games, you know, blocking field goals and those kind of things, blocking punts in the playoffs. He has a knack of being in position and then getting that paw over top of the ball. You know, he doesn't jump in the air. I mean, he works low. That hand just goes out at the right time. And so I think it's, you know, it's just kind of a knack that he has. And sometimes guys have it, sometimes they don't. There's a lot of guys who get really close to blocking a punt, but they never block one. PJ, if he's in the area, you know, he's going to get that paw right where it needs to be. He understands where the block point is. And he blocks well. PJ's a very intelligent player and very instinctual player. And it's amazing. He knows when that big play is coming, that he's going to – the Kennesaw State playoff game, it's a fourth down play. We stop them. We win the game. We don't stop them. They move in and possibly score, and they win the game. And they run a reverse, and you see PJ just plant his foot on the ground, turn and run, and runs down the speedy reverse back. And knocks him out of bounds three yards shy of the first down. I mean, that's who PJ is. PJ is just a really instinctual kid. Some people are really, you know, talented in terms of they can bench, they can squat, they can run a 40. This kid is a really good football player on top of all those things.
So let me ask this then. I mean, from everything that we've heard, obviously, they're building the past couple of days and speaking with you, it sounds like this guy is such a just a complete kind of, I mean, obviously always room to grow, right? No one comes into the NFL as a completely finished product. But if we look back a little bit, how does a guy like PJ kind of end up at an FCS school at, like, Sam Houston State? How does he kind of go under the radar of so many college top tier programs?
Perfect question. Smaller high school, playing defensive line and fullback, kind of playing both ways. Obviously, they must have liked his twitch, how explosive he was, but didn't even know what they had. And so sometimes those kind of things happen where guys, and especially Texas football. I mean, a lot of Texas football, it's the bigger schools, the 4A's, the 5A's, the 6A's. They have all the resources, and then when you start getting a little lower levels, they don't quite have all the resources. And sometimes those kids, fall through the cracks. I mean, there are some guys who play six-man football. Now, PJ didn't play six-man football, but there's six-man and eight-man football in Texas, too, with the real small, country towns where there's not a lot of kids in the high school. And you watch some of that tape, and you're shaking your head looking at some of the athletes they have. So, I think we were very fortunate that we walked into a situation where we could, let PJ grow as a player over a four-year period. And the more he played, I think the better he got. And there's some plays that you look at during the course of his career, you just shake your head. And one of those was, we had beaten Jacksonville State in the playoffs in, I think, 2014 and 2015. We had to play them again at their place. And they're getting after us pretty good. And PJ's upset now. PJ just, he's about to lose his mind because, we're not playing at the level we need to play at. And their running back, who's probably the fastest guy in the field, had a play up their sideline, and PJ's on the backside. He's in the defensive end position, the backside, and you see PJ go run this kid down. And this young man ended up playing like 2 years with the Seattle Seahawks at running back. And PJ runs him down, and I remember an entire sideline gasping because it was like, oh my God, did you just see that play? It's like he does some things, you just shake your head like, is that possible? Is it possible for a 308-pounder to vertical 38 inches. I mean, it wasn't that long ago. We were talking about David Thompson. Well, I guess it was that long ago. I'm showing my age. Yeah. But, I mean, they talked about his vertical 42 inches. Yeah, I mean, that's a great vertical. This kid's 308 pounds at vertical 38. So you can just tell that this kid has tremendous upside. It's going to be exciting to get him where he's playing 40 or 50 snaps a game, not 80 or 90 snaps a game. And again, I think, he has a very, very bright future. I think the Raiders did a great job getting him.
So I just want to back up just a little bit because there's something you said that I wrote down. I jotted real quick. So PJ was playing fullback in high school?
Yeah, he played like fullback, H-back. Trust me, he was always in my ear about, hey, coach, I've carried the ball before. It's like, yeah, PJ, I'm good.
Why didn't you let him?
Oh, short yardage. Oh, PJ, I'm good. Sometimes you have to let them know who's in control.
Oh, fair enough. Oh, man, I'm kind of having visions of, like, Dontari Poe at the goal line.
Well, you got to remember, we did lead the country in scoring, so we did have a lot of weapons. So it wasn't like we needed to bring another one over from defense, because I think my defensive coaches probably would have choked me also.
Sure.
But absolutely. So that's kind of the unique story about PJ. It's not like he came in as the number one recruit in the Sam Houston class. I mean, they redshirted him. They weren't sure where they were going to play him. They just took a really good football player that they thought was really explosive, and they'll figure it out later. And you have to give Willie Fritz and those guys a lot of credit for recognizing that this kid had some talent. And fortunately, he got that redshirt year. And my defensive line coach came in and did a great job with them. And then Rod Wright came and he played at UT and played 4 years in the league, and he did a great job with them. So it worked out for everybody. That I think we gave PJ some really good coaching at the defensive line spot between Phil Petit and Rod Wright, I think he took advantage of that.
In kind of looking at his, quote unquote draft profile that, all these, pundits write up for each of these guys, under the quote unquote weaknesses section, someone had wrote that his height was going to be one of the problems at the next level for him. And so someone asked him during his conference call, he said, you know, do you kind of see that as a weakness? And I thought he had a really interesting answer. He said, I mean, to be honest with you, not really. He goes, I play, you know, where I play with such a low center of gravity that being a little bit, not on the, I mean, he's 6 foot, 308 pounds, right? He's not a small guy, but he goes, being a little on, perhaps on the stouter side actually kind of helps me in kind of what I do. When, you know, as a football guy yourself, what kind of, I guess, hindrance does him maybe not being a little bit taller have? Or does, like, do you kind of agree with his assessment that it actually helps him do what he does best?
Well, this is what I told all the scouts, is that wait till you see him in an all-star game. Wait till you see him going up against the kids from Michigan and UCLA and USC and Texas. Wait till you see him there and see how he performs, because he's so sudden. He's so explosive. So it's not like, okay, he's a little bit shorter and we can get our hands on him. No, he's going to jack you back. I mean, you know, and you can't get under him because he is just a hair on the shorter side. You know, he measured in just over 6 foot, I think 6 1/2 inch. Like I said, I think PJ sees that as an advantage, not a disadvantage. The other thing is he's so good with his hands that I think he makes up for some of the shortness, you know. So when people get their hands on him, he does a really good job getting their hands off very quickly. So, you know, not only, like I said, is he, you know, this very unique athlete, but also he's just a really, really, really good football player that understands leverage and understands his strengths and studies his opponent. I mean, you know, PJ's a guy who will put the time in because he just loves to play football, just loves to play.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, one thing that we were talking about a little while ago is that, you know, for a guy like PJ, for a guy who you said kind of came unheralded through high school and obviously ending up at Sam Houston State, that first year, that first NFL year, and having the chance to be in an NFL strength and conditioning program, in an NFL nutrition program, you know, you look at some of the guys that have come our way from smaller schools, and you look at their bodies when they're, you know, they get here day one as rookies, and you fast forward 365 days. I mean, there is a huge difference. I mean, obviously,
right.
I mean, you look at Khalil Mack, and Khalil's built like, you know, chiseled out of granite. But it's interesting to go look back to when he first got here on campus to what he looks like now, and he is filled out immensely. And so I'm kind of interested to see how the next year on that in that area of his game goes for PJ as well.
Yeah, and PJ loves to train, so he'll take in that strength coach, and he'll eat up every word. And like I said, you don't put up the numbers he put up without being tremendously dedicated, tremendously focused, and obviously having a lot of God-given ability.
So I'll ask you real quick: best, when you think of, you know, of PJ, is there like a quintessential PJ game, like a game where you're like, you know, is this? Did you have a moment where you're like, all right, this guy can really play at the next level and perform very well?
Well, like I said, I think that play he made against Jacksonville State, it was just a jaw dropper. You know, he's made so many great plays. It's just, oh, there's just another great one. But when he ran down their running back from the backside, and you see him running by our linebackers and our safeties and everyone, he's just flying. You know, at that point, you go, you know what? I knew he was special, but I didn't realize, like, he was that special. Like, he was at a level that maybe I didn't even understand, because I didn't think that was possible what he just did. So yeah, there's been a number of moments, but that was the one I think that really stood out, you know, in terms of, wow, that play is freakish.
Yeah, I know. I think I know exactly what you're saying, because I remember a couple years ago we had just signed Rodney Hudson, our center, and we were playing the then San Diego Chargers, and there was a little screen pass, I think it was to Amari Cooper. And you look down the screen, and all of a sudden, Big Rodney, Rodney's got to be pushing, he's probably about 300 pounds too, all of a sudden comes out of nowhere, and he's lead blocking for one of the fastest wide receivers we have on the roster. And you're like, okay, like, I see why they give this guy the big extension, all the big money. Like, you don't see big fellas do that all that often.
Right. Well, like I said, when he made that play, you could hear a gasp on our sidelines, because everyone saw him just run by everybody on the field. So, and it reminded me very much of that Kennesaw State play where, you know, they're running reverse and he's headed left and he just puts his foot in the ground and turns and takes the perfect angle because, again, he's just a natural football player. He just understands angles and leverage and those things, takes the perfect angle and tracks down a very speedy back who was running the reverse and knocked him out of bounds. And, you know, they were like 3 yards short of the first down, and we won the game. So, that's the kind of plays we're excited. And again, I think you're going to see a different kid because he's going to be playing 40 or 50 snaps a game. He's not going to be playing, you know, 80 snaps a game.
Sure.
So, again, I'm excited for that because I think a lot of times just because how good he was, we couldn't get him off the field. And, again, he demanded to be on special teams. He was like, Coach, I just feel it's part of my responsibility to help on teams. And so we gave him that opportunity to play on teams too. So he played a lot of snaps of college football.
And that's got to be music to the ears of our special teams coordinator, Rich Bisaccia. So, Coach, I really appreciate your time. I'll get you out of here on this. Just as far as off the field stuff, what kind of guy is PJ? I mean, what should we be expecting? Is he a big jokester? Is he a very, you know, strong silent type? What are we getting here?
Well, yeah, he's kind of a quiet kid, but he has a funny personality. He's a funny kid. Loves to be with his teammates. He'll get along with everybody. Like, there's no one who's not going to like him. You know, it's just like he got 98% of the votes on for captain. You know, no one gets 98% of the votes for captain. You know, I mean, that's just the way it is. I mean, he's just one of those guys that everyone likes. So, just a real genuine kid who's very appreciative of his opportunity. And I think he's ready to seize that opportunity. I think what you'll realize, he's never going to take this for granted. Like, this is special. And sometimes when you get guys from a little lower level, you know, the FCS and those kind of things, those guys, the dream came true. And now they're going to fulfill the dream. And I think that's what you're going to see with PJ.
Awesome, Coach. So Coach Casey Keeler down at Sam Houston State, good enough to take a couple minutes for us. And Coach, I appreciate the time. Thanks so much. Congratulations. And if you ever make it out here, shoot us a line and holler at us.
Absolutely. I appreciate it. Thanks, guys.
All right. A huge thank you to Coach Keeler. Like I said, really busy time of the year for him. And we certainly appreciate his time on the Official Raiders podcast. And so bonus episode, we're out. That was it. Just a little conversation and learn more about PJ Hall. We certainly learned a lot, and I hope you guys did too. But like I said, big thank you to Coach Keeler. Per usual, big thank you to producer Trav for making sure we sound good, sound better than we actually do in real life. And we'll be back soon. Like we said yesterday, rookie minicamp on the horizon. And yeah, we're back. We're in full football mode, and it feels good. So have a good week, fellas, and we'll catch you next time on the Official Raiders Podcast.
Thanks for listening to the official podcast of the Oakland Raiders.